strong. Hi, everybody. Miss Cleo's here. Are you ready to get started? Let's get started.
So, hello, everyone. Our lesson this week is on Adam and Eve are tempted, and it's out of the book of Genesis, chapter 3, verses 1 through 21. Now, I'm going to send it over to Miss Latoya for our memory verse and prayer.
It's time for our memory verse. Hey, welcome back. It's time for another verse. This week, we're in the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 11, verse 3. But first, I have some vocab words to add to your list. Our first word, fear. That means afraid. Second word, serpent. That means snake. Next word is deceived. That means trick. Next word is craftiness. That means you're skilled at something you're good at. So maybe you're good at drawing, so you're crafty, craftiness. Next word is corrupted. That means to act dishonest. And last word is simplicity. That means simple. So here's our verse. But I fear lest somehow, as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, so your mind may be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. So that's 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3. Keep practicing. See you next time. All right, it's time for our prayer to start our lesson. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Dear Lord, thank you for another Sunday to hear your word. Thank you for allowing us to have your word by Miss Cleo. Allow us to remove any distractions so that we can learn today. And allow us to share what we have learned today with someone. Thank you for your healing. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for health. Amen. Back to Miss Cleo for our lesson for today.
So welcome back, everyone. And as I said, our story today is Adam and Eve are tempted. It's out of the book of Genesis, chapter 3, verses 1 to 21. And so now just a quick review. What was our story about last week? It was about a certain garden, the Garden of Eden. Who made it? God made it. Who lived there? The first man, Adam, and woman, Eve, lived there as husband and wife. They were married. Now, how else was it described? It was described as paradise, a place that was so happy and stressless. I mean, it was beautiful, plants and trees. What else could you ask for? Now, there was a certain tree that was mentioned last week. Does anybody remember that? There was a tree that God gave instructions to Adam and Eve not to eat from. Yes, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. God told Adam and Eve, do not eat from this tree, for in the day that you do this, you will surely die. You can eat from everything else, but do not eat from this tree. This story is important because from our disobedience, that brings about sin. And we're going to see a lot of the world today, why bad things happen, is because of our disobedience, sin, and why bad things even happen with us. So this is a very important story. Now, I'm going to read it from the Jesus Storybook Bible by Sally Lloyd-Jones and written by Jago. So I'm actually not going to read it out of our Bible. I'm going to read it out of this story. And it's pretty much the same, but you can follow along in your Bible if you like. And this title is The Terrible Lie. Adam and Eve lived happily together in their beautiful new home, and everything was perfect for a while. Until the day when everything went wrong. God had a horrible enemy. His name was Satan. Satan had once been the most beautiful angel, but he didn't want to be just an angel. He wanted to be God. He grew proud and evil and full of hate, and God had sent him out of heaven. Satan was seething with anger and looking for ways to hurt God. He wanted to stop God's plan, stop this love story right there. So he disguised himself as a snake and waited in the garden. Now God had given Adam and Eve only one rule. Don't eat the fruit of that tree, God told them. Because if you do, you'll think you know everything, you'll stop trusting me, and then death and sadness and tears will come. You see, God knew that if they ate the fruit, they would think they didn't need him, and they would try to make themselves happy without him. But God knew there was no such thing as happiness without him, and life without him wouldn't be life at all. As soon as the snake saw his chance, he slithered silently up to Eve. "Does God really love you?" the serpent whispered. "If he does, why don't he let you eat the nice, juicy, delicious fruit? Poor you. Perhaps God doesn't want you to be happy." The snake's words hissed into her ears and sunk down deep into her heart like poison. "Does God love me?" Eve wondered. Suddenly she didn't know anymore. "Just trust me," the serpent whispered. "You don't need God. One small taste, that's all, and you'll be happier than you could ever dream." Eve picked the fruit and ate some, and Adam ate some too. And a terrible lie came into the world. It would never leave. It would live on in every human's heart, whispering to every one of God's children, "God doesn't love me." Now listen, did God love Adam and Eve? Of course he did. He made a home for them. They didn't have any needs at all. God loved them. Satan was once an angel, and he wanted to be like God. And God said, "There's only one God, and that's me." And he kicked them out. And now he is whispering into Eve's ear this lie. Because God told them, once you eat from this tree, you're going to die. But now, Satan is saying something different. And the bad thing about it is Eve is listening to him. She shouldn't be listening, but she listened to him. She ate. Now, to just continue on. And it wasn't a dream, it was a nightmare. A dove flew from Adam's hand. A deer darted in a thicket. It was as if they were frightened by something. A chill was in the air. Something strange was happening. They had always been naked, but now they felt naked and wrong. And they didn't want anyone to see them, so they hid. Later that evening, as God was taking his walk, he called to them, "Children." Usually Adam and Eve loved to hear God's voice and would run to him. But this time, they ran away from him and hid in the shadows. "Where are you?" God called. "Hiding," Adam said. "We're afraid of you." "Did you eat the fruit I told you not to eat?" God asked them. And Adam said, "Eve made me do it." "What have you done?" God asked. Eve said, "The serpent made me do it." And terrible pain came into God's heart. His children hadn't just broken the one rule, they had broken God's heart. They had broken their wonderful relationship with him. And now he knew everything else would break. God's creation would start to unravel and come undone and go wrong. From now on, everything would die, even though it was all supposed to last forever. Now, they have eaten this fruit. They realize they are naked. God calls out to them. They are hiding. God says, "What have you done?" They did not listen to him. And now, everything that God created is now unraveling. It is coming apart. But God got a plan. It's not a sad story. God has a plan. He does. He has a plan for us. And that is where Jesus comes into the picture. And he is our Savior, our Redeemer. You know, God shows that he has gracious. He has showed his gracious mercy on a sinful man. And that's what Adam and Eve were afterwards, because they had not listened to God and sin came in the world, but God still came up with a plan for them. So let's just read on. You see, sin had come into God's perfect world and it would never leave. God's children would always be running from him and hiding in the dark. Their hearts would break down and would never properly work again. God couldn't let his children live forever, not in such pain, not without him. There was only one way to protect them. "You will have to leave the garden now," God told his children, his eyes filling with tears. "This is no longer your true home. It's not the place for you anymore." But before they left the garden, God made clothes for his children to cover them. He gently clothed them and he sent them away on a long, long journey out of the garden, out of their home. Well, in another story, it would be over and that would have been the end. But not in this story. God loved his children too much to let the story end there. Even though he knew he would suffer, God had a plan, a magnificent dream. One day he would get his children back. One day he would make the world their perfect home again. And one day he would wipe away every tear from their eyes. You see, no matter what, in spite of everything, God would love his children with a never stopping, never giving up, unbreaking, and always and forever love. And though they would forget him and run from him deep in their hearts, God's children would miss him always and long for him. Lost children yearning for their home. Before they left the garden, God whispered a promise to Adam and Eve. "It will not always be so. I will come to rescue you. And when I do, I'm going to do battle against the snake. I'll get rid of the sin and the dark and the sadness you let in here. I'm coming back for you." And he would one day, God himself would come. And that's the end of that story. So God did have a plan, and his plan was Jesus Christ, because that was the only way for us to come back to God. And we just thank God every day for him having mercy on us. So I hope you like that story. That's the end for this week, and I'll see you next week.
Well, everyone, that's it for today. I'll see you again next time. Bye-bye. You're strong. You're strong.